Let's get started. This is where we'll start tonight. We're going back into a lesson on preparing for the harvest. And this is actually lesson eight. Lesson eight, preparing for the harvest. And this is going to be, as far as I know, entitled Laying On of Hands. Laying Hands on the Sick. Maybe that's the best title. These guys can help me figure it out later. But why don't you turn with me to Mark's Gospel, chapter 16, the last one. And let's read something together. And then I'm going to ask us to make a confession together. Now, over the last several weeks, this one being the eighth, we've been on this particular subject, preparing for the harvest. And this truly is what we are doing. We are, through His Word, we're doing everything that we possibly can to prepare ourselves for what is coming. And we believe with all of our hearts that there is a coming harvest that is going to be such the like that we've never seen before. And we want to do everything we can. We want to prepare the cradle or the nursery with everything in preparation. And there are certain academics that we're going to do to provide for them being the lost when they come in and get saved. But you're the ones that are going to go out there and do it. And before there's ever a sweeping crowd in here, you're the ones that the Holy Spirit is going to be using. And so we're just going line on line on a number of different things that the Holy Spirit is impressing on us, particularly to say at this given time. Now, let's look at Mark chapter 16, and let me read, and you follow along with me, a very familiar portion of Scripture, verses 15 through 18. Jesus said to them, and this is His going away statement, this is His conclusion to us, the church, as He's the Great Commission, they call it. And He said unto them, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be," what? "Saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall," what? "They shall recover." Hallelujah. Say this with me, please. Father, Your Word says that I will lay hands on the sick and see them recover. Amen. Recover means get perfectly well. That does not mean some of the time. It means all the time. That does not mean certain sicknesses.
That does not mean certain sicknesses.
That means every sickness,
that means every sickness,
every disease, and every infirmity.
And every infirmity.
That does not mean certain people.
That does not mean certain people.
It means all people.
It means all people.
I will not stop. No matter how long it takes.
No
matter how many people. I pray for before I see a 100-fold manifestation. My experience will not form my doctrine. My doctrine is formed by the Word of God.
Your word
is forever settled in heaven. 1,000 contradictory experiences are not my evidence. My evidence is Your Word alone. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. we're on the cusp of something great, and that is the harvest. It seems as if from the very top of the circle of which the family, it's more of the better word would be family, from the very top of our family, as in the elders of the elders and people that we all and I tremendously respect, are facing great among us and elsewhere in the eldership of this family, of the circle of family that we have come to know over the last 20 years, seem to be facing some of the most contradictory arguments against what we confess and what we believe that has ever been presented to the church. And these contradictory arguments are trying to present themselves as evidence that this, and if you're listening, I'm holding up my Bible, this doesn't work. But let me say again what you just said with me. The evidence is not in the experience. The evidence is in the Word of God. And I might say it again. I'll say it right now because it can bear repeating over and over again. It doesn't matter what you go through. It does matter. But what the conclusion of that is, what you see, what I see, what you see that could ever happen, or whatever I could go through, or how the end result is. The bottom line is that our doctrine is formed by the Word of God, and not by anyone's, or any elders, or any preacher, or anybody that we love experience. Experience must be dictated. The outcome of experience must be sheltered over and dictated to by the doctrine which comes from this Word. Throughout the ages, if you study history in revival, the enemy has always come with the same things that he's ever come with, and that's scripted in Mark chapter 4. All of the different persecutions and the different afflictions and all the different arguments, those are arguments of the truth of the Word of God. They're distractions to the church, and they're everything that he could ever come with. The spiritual warfare that is described in Ephesians 6 is all contained. He can't go anywhere outside of Mark chapter 4. It's all contained in Mark chapter 4. The persecution, the affliction, the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things. He's only got a certain amount of things that he can possibly try to get across. He can come with diseases. He can come with poverty. He can come with separation of families. He can come with a lot of different things. And his whole desire is to try to get people so involved in their experience that eventually, if they go through enough things and there is enough things stacked on top of each other, that it'll wear them out. It'll eventually wear them out, and they will begin to resolve through their intellect that, look, you know, we're the best of the best, and we're the cream of the crop. We're doing our best, and you know, we're fasting and praying, and if these things are happening to us, you know, is this really real? And he will eventually do. I went through something I'd say I'm probably going into the second year, or not going in, but maybe 2 years past something that was a real extreme spiritual fight. My wife shared that with me. Close friends shared that with me. and prayed for me during that time. It was just a real spiritual battle. That was it in a nutshell. I wasn't in sin. I didn't have any hang-ups in that way. I was just going through a real spiritual battle. One of the things that I'm 2 years probably past that now, and I would say by my own testimony, as God being my witness, that I'm probably walking in the greatest amount of consistent peace that I've ever had going into these last couple of years. Just a consistent day in, day out. Now, don't get me wrong. We're always in a warfare. We're always having to make consistent choices. But I'm talking about a deep, settled peace and a quietness and a just the word that has been washing over me and just coming and coming and coming. One of the things that the Lord, the way that he brought me through that, and I'll share this with you because he's prompting me now to do that, is one of the handles that the enemy used, now that I look back on it, when you don't ever, the worst time to make judgments is inside the trial. Just write it out in the word and pray in tongues and do what, but don't, the worst thing you can do is start trying to make decisions inside the trial and try make conclusions. The Lord, and I believe this will help you too, because we're all going to face trials between now and when we go home, right? Dave used to say this, you're either one of three places. You're either the beginning of one, the middle of one, or one's finishing up. And sometimes they just come like bananas and, you know, it's like you're playing, you know, cymbals, like that one's getting done, praise God, but I got two more over here that I'm working with and this. But in the midst of it, it's peace. But the Lord shared with me, one of the things was that it was a mantra that he put inside of me during that time, and it was straight from God. He said, rule, don't reason. Rule, don't reason. And to me, that meant rule out of my spirit and stop the reasoning. In other words, when you're going through something, if it lasts very long, you'll start trying to figure out why it's there. I can tell you why trials are there, because they're trials. Now, unless you're messing around, now if you're committing adultery and you're looking at bad stuff and you're not repenting from that and you're consistently doing it, the beating that you're getting from the devil is not a trial. That's just an open door, okay? So you guys understand that. So people, a lot of times, much of the church doesn't understand what true trials are. They think that they're in a trial, and the devil's. There's two reasons why the devil beat you. He beat up on you. One is that you're going into the Word of God, and you're a threat to him, and he hates you, and he wants to kill you or do whatever he can to you. The other one is that you're his boy, right? You're his boy or you're his girl. And you're lying enough or you're in deep enough hatred that he's just got something he can twist on the inside of you. If you get past that searching part and know that you're clean, you're not perfect, you may go through something where you have to forgive somebody six times a day, every day, okay? Or you may have to, there may be a lot of different things. But if you're going into God, and you know you're not perfect, but you're going into his word, he will come with different tests and trials. The worst thing that you could possibly, and this is leading to something that we were saying a moment ago, the worst thing that you can possibly do is start trying to figure it out. Just say, wait a minute, I love God, and I've repented of all that, if there's something to repent for, and I'm just going to keep going into him, and devil, you're not, so if he hangs around or whatever he does, you just keep marching, but don't try to figure things out. If you do, you'll get legalistic because you'll put parameters, well, maybe it's this or maybe it's that, and God, and then you'll start being critical of other people too once you get legalistic. Legalistic people are critical of other people, by the way. Just get kind of write that one down. What are you talking about? Well, everything's a sin. Well, if everything's, you get around somebody that everything's a sin, and then you can just bet one thing, they're critical towards other people, okay? So, hallelujah. You guys are quiet. Hallelujah. but you're listening. If, and so this isn't even in my notes, he's just talking, the Lord's talking. If the enemy can bring enough sessions, he'll put you through college. He'll put you through his school of theology. In other words, if you're not banking on this and you're looking at that's going on and that elder is going through hell and that elder is going through hell and that elder died and this one happened and that one, if you begin to look at that, you will be self-educated. If you begin to really look at it, if you begin to be self-educated, and you won't even know that you begin to try to figure out the reasons why. Once you get into a place where the fulcrum, that's the focus, the front part, when revival and going into God becomes something inside of you, because it's inside of me and it's inside of all of us, it's not that, I think more than ever before, you begin to love people and you begin to pull with them in their infirmity. But we have our marching orders, and our marching order says this. There's two places that we found recently, and we're not going to turn them right there. Hopefully I'll get to Mark 16. But there's two confirmations. Matthew 24:14, which is, and this gospel, which one? The one that he preached, it will be preached unto all people of all nations, and then shall the end come. In other words, the demonstration that I've been demonstrating, that will happen. And Joel chapter 2 that we went over last couple weeks ago, and we finished up last week, is that there will come an army in the last days that it says there was never an army like them, and there never will be an army after them, such the like. In other words, somebody finishes up, and somebody finishes up well, and it should go out with a crescendo, and it should go out with a bang, and it should go out with a people that are full and filled, and they bring him back. Hallelujah. Amen? I say, why not us and why not now? Praise God. And so we're going to get the... But one of the things is there's going to be peripherals. There's going to be in front of you. Listen, if your best friend dies, don't figure it out. Don't try to figure out, what is it? Why? I don't quite... Keep marching. If your next best friend dies, keep marching. I'm not going to, but if I die, keep marching. There's never a place where anybody, because somebody makes it. And all the ones that do go on prior to us, when they get there, they are telling us. Candy was listening to something today, and she said something to me. I'd heard it, but she repeated again to me that those people that are champions in his book, that made it, and I'm talking about people that maybe be generals that you might know or have known, if they go home early for whatever reason, because they're in the fight, we don't stop to try to figure it all out, because we know one thing, if they could send back a message, and they really are through our mouthpieces, they would say, look, don't stop. Don't even take recess to try to figure it out. Keep marching, 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 because somebody's going to make it. And so all of everything that anybody could ever be going through that really knows him and is really, and again, please, you know, when I start talking about how the enemy can come in, it kind of gets quiet. People start, oh, well, what do I have in my life? Listen, there's two things here we've got to reconcile. Remember that he's been saying, and there was a prophecy, judgment is coming, and then the commentary was that judgment is coming with great distinction. He said this, and I'm just trying to paraphrase, or I'm just trying to remember. He said that, I want you to go into the harvest. You're going to be imperfect, but go in. Do this part, stay in prayer, but go into the harvest with all your imperfections. Don't wait until you're totally perfect. Listen, you can have a fault and still preach or teach as far, you know, witness to your friends, present the word to them. The only thing that won't go well is if you have the fault and you're not doing anything about it. I mean, seriously doing something about it, especially if it's a one of them ones that people don't want to talk about. If you're not praying, if you're not spending time, and then you're acting like, you know, you and Jesus just got everything going, and you're not doing anything about it, now that will get you in trouble. That'll get you in trouble. The devil will come and pop you a good one, and you'll be laying in the ditch wondering what, looking up, wondering what happened, okay? So, hallelujah. So we're getting ready for the harvest, and it is coming. Everybody say it's coming. Let's say this, it's coming and now is. Hallelujah. Do like this, stretch a little bit, okay? Hallelujah, good, okay. Get some blood going there. Hallelujah. Last week we talked about assisting people in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Wasn't that good? So that gives you some real practical, I think there was 10 different steps. The PDF is on the website. We appreciate what these guys do. I appreciate Candy. I appreciate what these guys do. As I said, I haven't had a chance to talk to Alex. I think some good things are coming to our website, and it's going to be more, what do they call it? Modern, of course, yeah, but user-friendly. Okay. So I think it is pretty much now, but it's going to even increase. So, hallelujah. So these signs, and the last one was, they shall do what? Lay hands on the sick, and they will what? Recover. Now, I don't know how many in this room, I hope it's almost everybody, but how many has you yourself have laid hands, whether it be here or someplace else in your family or whatever, and you've prayed for somebody? That's almost everybody in here. You've actually physically put your hands. Wonderful. Hallelujah. How many have seen God, you know, move, and you felt like that they recovered quick enough or in due time that you felt like that prayer made a difference? Now, does anybody? Wow, that's about the same amount. Praise God. Hallelujah. We're cooking with gas. That's good. What's that? Oh, Candy says, don't ask the next question. I'm not sure what that, she's got a question going on. So the harvest is this. It's not just the gospel of salvation. I think we all understand that here. That is preached in the fundamentalist churches. The fundamentalist, you know, the good Baptist, the good Methodist churches. That's the gospel that they teach people. Now, like if we were having a discipleship training class in a good Baptist church, and I'm not, you know, against the Baptist. Pastor Dave said, where would we ever get our people from if it wasn't for the Baptists? Praise God for them. But seriously, we would be teaching how, you know, the Roman road and how you present the gospel. And the gospel to them, praise God, they accurately teach how to get saved. But that's not the only gospel. I mean, that's not the only message in the gospel. That is the main, get to heaven. But his message was much more encompassing. It was the blind see, the lame walk, and everything that we see in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Praise the Lord. The true gospel encompasses everything. Discipleship training teaches us how not only to present the gospel in word, but also in works, in truth, in word and truth. In other words, I want to be neat when we come to the place where we can say, if I can't do it, then don't believe me. If the works that if I can't do this, if this doesn't happen, then can I go pray for your little sister? Can I go pray for your little brother? And, you know, everything I've been talking and all that, you know, I've been telling you week after week at work, if it doesn't happen, then skip it. Forget it. That's boldness. Hallelujah. One of the great, you know, the modern day apostles, or I think it was Smith Wigglesworth. I'm pretty sure this was Smith. That there's a boldness that comes in the Lord. Really, it's a boldness. Now I know that there's sometimes it seems like there's a thin line between boldness and presumption. But when you really know Him, and he saw a man one time on the street, and he was on one side of the street, and the guy was across the street, and the guy was a cripple or something like that. And he said to the guy, he yelled across, and of course people can hear this, "Sir, Do you believe Jesus can heal you? And of course, Smith's about to pray for him and get him healed. And he said, I don't know. He said, well, if he doesn't, God is a liar. God's an absolute liar. And so, you know, the story is, as far as I remember, he went, you know, that's the deal. He went and got him healed right then. But Kenneth Hagin, you know, he walked in that kind of, you know, he walked in that kind of, he'd say things to the Lord like, oh man, you got to know him. You know, the Lord told him, asked him to give up everything and start. He pastored for a long time, and then the Lord told him later, he said, he's pastored for several years, and then he had a visitation with God, and God asked him to go out on the evangelistic field or start going around and teaching his teaching ministry. And he said, well, Lord, you called me to pastor. And the Lord said, no, I never did. He said, what? He goes, I've been pastoring all these years. He goes, no, I never asked you to pastor one time. He said, you just heard the call and you just went and started. You never took the time to figure out and ask me what I wanted. He said, I want you to go out there. And he said, man, he had a rough time leaving his family, his wife, and he had, I think, two kids, little kids. And he's like, man, there wasn't hardly anything to begin with, and now he's going to just resign his pastorate. And the Lord said, no, do it. And he said, okay, Lord, I'll do it. And he said, if I ever, one time, if I ever get a hole in my shoe, if my needs are not met, he said, I'm going to go around and tell everybody I can talk to, that you don't keep your end of the bargain. I'll tell everybody. Now, that's boldness, that's brassness, but he absolutely knew that God was going to keep his word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't try that unless you're really walking in a place. Laying hands on the sick is no, listen, I don't want it to be. I think you feel this way. I don't want laying hands on the sick or praying for the sick to be a token. Like, that's what we're supposed to do. Candy had to leave today. She, you know, we're always busy. But then she got a call that is like the bat phone. One of our grandkids was sick. That's the bat phone. Everything drops. I'm sorry, folks. Whatever we promised you, it goes out the window. One of our grandkids, Amber, was her littlest one. This thing came in through the house the last couple days. She was sick and vomiting, and then Aubrey was at school, and she was sick. And so Nana, you know, so gone. It doesn't matter. So when she got over there, she put her on FaceTime, I was looking at her. Well, Aubrey couldn't talk to me. She was so sick, and they wanted me to pray. Well, I'd already prayed. Well, I prayed, but I tell you what, when you're looking in the face of your grandchild or your child, it's different, okay? And they're expecting you to do something. Listen, I want to be a person that when daddy's called or grandpa's called or mama, or that you can make a difference. That it's not like, okay, let's pray a prayer. Forget, I'm tired of Band-Aid prayers. Like, people pray it to like, okay, that's the thing a Christian's supposed to do. Let's just pray the prayer. I want my prayers to really have a punch to them. I mean, really. That's why a lot of times people, and I've tried my best, and sometimes I still mess up. A lot of times people will be talking, and then people will say, you know, real fast, like, pray for me, pray for me. Listen, most people's prayers, and that, God bless them. We've all done this, so I'm not preaching at you. I'm preaching with you. Most people's prayers are just kind of like, now I lay me down to sleep. They're just kind of like shotgun prayers, or you shoot. The effectual fervent prayer. Elijah, in the book of James, the Bible says that when God told him to go up to the mount and pray for rain, that he went up there. I couldn't do it if I tried. He put his head between his knees. He wasn't practicing yoga. He was in deep focus, absolutely focus. He And a lot of times people, we all do it. Remember me pray. Okay, I'll pray for you. I'll pray for you. And we'll just say it as a byword. I'll pray for you. I'll pray for you. And you never think about them people after that. Well, I do, Pastor. Well, I don't. A lot of times. I'll pray for you. Okay. If it's on a slide, you know, people just say, I pray. Listen, I want mine to be, because when I pray, if I make a commitment to you and say, Pastor, will you pray? When you give me, a lot of times I won't even present that. Now, if it's an emergency, I'll pray right then. Okay. But a lot of times people say, pray. Okay. And I say, okay, I'll pray. I won't present that until the next day or the day after, whatever, because when I pray, I present my petition listening, and I'm praying the word, and I'm praying the mind of Christ. In other words, if you're privileged enough to get me to pray for you, you're getting somebody to pray for you. Now you say that's egotistical. No, Jesus said, Peter, Satan has desired to sift you. Because a lot of times you say, pray for me. Yeah, pray. A thousand people doing a shotgun little dibby, a ditty, doesn't make as much difference as one or two or three prayer warriors that'll go in there, put everything out, and really go in there and get something done. Because multiple prayers are not what, authority is what gets it done. Multiplicity, God's not, we've got 1,000 people, just, God help them. Oh, I prayed for them, God help them. Okay, well, praise God if God, you know, if that's sincere. But what about investing past God help them? It's like, really, you praying for somebody, if you make a commitment, if your friend or somebody says, would you pray for me? It should be, you know, the Supreme Court doesn't hear but like 1/100 of the 1/1,000 of the cases. I won't hear that. I'm not saying don't pray for people. I'm just saying when you make a commitment to prayer, make it a very conscious, okay, I will, like the Supreme Court, okay, I'll hear that case. Okay, I'll receive your case. All right? I will pray for you. For you to pray for somebody, it should be a privilege for them because you've gone to a place where you can get something done. In other words, it's not just a token. Hallelujah. We often make a commitment, I'll pray for somebody, and that makes them feel good, but forget, I don't want you to make me feel good. I want you to help me get something done. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. Wow. It's pretty amazing. So don't get weary in well-doing. That's part of the message. We need to continue to rejoice in this. Here's the things, even if we're not yet having, don't get exasperated to where you're endurance. You say, well, I see all these things. Here's a number of things. Here's a number of things to rejoice in as far as where we've made it to this far. I don't care the number of crowds or the number in the crowd or what looks spectacular. Here's a number of things. Number one, we do know His will. Amen? So we made it that far. You could be, and I could be, going to a church or to a place where we didn't even know His will. We didn't know that it's His will all the time, what we just confess, all the time, to heal everybody all the time. So we've made it that, we're at least to that base. Hallelujah. And then the other thing that we've made it to is this. Anything less is not acceptable. Okay? Anything less than getting to His will is not acceptable. In other words, people dying around us, that's not acceptable. Okay? We will also, we know where that exists at. We know, in other words, how to get there. Don't we? And we're learning more of how that works, how to get there. We're learning, in other words, it's not a mystery to us how this works. Somebody, let's say this again. Somebody is going to make it. Let's say it together.
I say
that somebody,
some group,
makes it.
Why not us?
And why not now? Hallelujah. Well, at least we know. Well, Pastor, people listening too, so I got to be careful. Pastor, I go to a church where they don't preach healing and they don't preach in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And by the way, I've got a sick child that has a disease. What would you suggest? I suggest that you leave that church. Leave that church. Find a church that preaches like this. And if that doesn't exist in your locale, then make this church or something like it your church. Because we're broadcast. But you can't afford to sit in churches where they don't believe in healing. Now, be nice about it. Don't be a Sunday school teacher and not show up one Sunday. Give them plenty of room to know that you're leaving. That sounds hard, but it's true. Hallelujah. Yeah, pack up and move, somebody said over here. Ralph said, pack up and move. Where would they move to, Ralph? Immokalee. Hallelujah. You know, I was saying this to Candy today. This is amazing because we have not yet seen, you know, the miracles of... Now, I've seen miracles. I have. And I could be one of those ones that raised my hand, my prayer when I laid hands on people. And I hope we'll get to the practical part of how to lay hands, because most of you have already done that. But I've seen people healed in my life, but I haven't seen all the spectacular. I haven't seen the mirror. A lot of times people will be looking for the spectacular and they pass miracles, but those real spectacular miracles, you know, it like where the blind see and the lame or like a maimed person, not so much of those that I have been a part of, but if you would have, I told Candy today, we were talking about this, I don't know what century I've read it before, but somebody listening probably knows. But if you study like the Black Plague that went through Europe, like there, it really did kill over a series of time, like not tens of millions. It was like 200 million or something like that. It went through all of Europe, and I think they got into parts of Africa and stuff. I mean, millions and millions of people. It just desecrated whole civilizations. If you were to ask a person that their parents died and their children died, and during the Black Plague, during those times, if you just said, "Do you believe that there will come a point in time where this is so eradicated, this disease is so there's vaccines for it, and it'll be so eradicated from the earth that people won't even know what the Black Plague is?" Would you believe that? They would say, "Absolutely not. This is my experience. Everybody, my granddaddy died of it. It's been here in this village and in this area for the last, you know, 20 years, 30 years. My parents died of it. I've got children, 4 or 5 children's died of it." Their experience would have absolutely, that you would have never convinced them that a time would come where those things, you know, technology brought in vaccines that eventually, now nobody, you know, what was that? You know, well, that's not existent in our society. In the same way, there is coming a time when the glory of the Lord is going to be so strong and so powerful that we'll look back. We've said this before, but it bears repeating, and we'll say, we got here. And to us right now, it seems like at times in our natural thoughts an impossibility, but it is a possibility. It is a very distinct possibility. Hallelujah. I want to talk about the works of Jesus for a moment, because laying hands on the sick is, how many of you believe that the works that he did, well, let's go to that verse. Let's go to John chapter 14, because I want you to see it, even though it may be familiar to us. John chapter 14, verse 12. This is Jesus. at the Last Supper, and he says this. John chapter 14 and verse 12. Truly, truly, or verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to what? My Father. Again, he says, he that believeth on me. How many of you out there believes on Christ? In other words, you know he's there. Okay, and besides for that, you've been baptized in the Spirit. You've been baptized with the Holy Ghost. Well, this is what he promises us. He promises us that the same works that he did, you'll do also. And greater works than these shall you do, because I go to the Father. Well, we understand, without going into that tremendous message, that the greater works was that Jesus never led anybody into salvation when he was on planet Earth. Why? Because he was not yet glorified. The greater works is that you as a disciple and I as a disciple get to take them to the greater work, which is what he provided through his death, burial, and resurrection, the salvation of eternity for their eternal existence. But the works that he did, he said this, you'll do those and you'll also be able to lead them into the kingdom, is in essence what he was saying. Well, how many of you believe, and you just know this, that everything that he described for us in Mark chapter 16, that he did. I mean, did he cast out devils? Yes. Did he lay hands on the sick? Yes, he did. Well, somebody said, well, he didn't speak in tongues. Well, you know, but that's another subject, totally another subject. But he was filled, and we could go into that, but he was filled with the Holy Ghost. Was he? Absolutely so. He was filled with the Holy Ghost. And let's look at Luke's Gospel, chapter 3. Hallelujah, all you Bible-thumping, Bible-believing scholars. Let's look at Luke chapter 3, verse 21 and 22. Verse 21 says this, and now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heavens opened, and the Holy Ghost descending in a bodily shape like a dove upon him, and the voice came from heaven, which said, thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. This is what? His baptism, his physical water baptism, but the baptism of the Holy Spirit when he is filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, somebody might say, well, no, it says the Holy Ghost came upon him, but in context with this same chapter, we won't go into all the begats there, but in chapter 4, the very next chapter, and it says, and Jesus being what? You there? Are you there in that? Turn to chapter 4, Luke 4. And Jesus being what? Full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Now, so the Holy Ghost, this is the same time frame, this is just what happened. As soon as he's baptized in water, he's also filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, obviously, we understand this. God doesn't fill God. So God filled who? Jesus in his humanity. He filled him in his human spirit, just like he fills us in our human spirit. So that's how Jesus was filled with the Holy Ghost. Let's look at another scripture. Acts 10 and let's look at verse 38. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the what? Who with who? The Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing, how many? All that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Hallelujah. Jesus worked under the anointing of his Father through the power of the Holy Ghost. He did no miracles before his Holy Ghost baptism. This is what we have to understand. Jesus, obviously, we understand that he was born into this earth with what we affectionately called the born-again spirit. It was not born again for him, because he was just born into this earth with a human spirit that had the full life, sinlessness in it, and it had the life of the Father. It was a human spirit, but it was just like, I have, when I say I have the Spirit of Christ, I have a born-again fill of born-again spirit from God, of God, that is in the full nature and scope of who God is and His righteousness and His holiness and it's not deity, but it is, comes from deity, and it has everything of the life of God in it. That's what Jesus came into this earth with. But on top of that, Jesus was baptized. His human spirit was baptized, and He became full of the Holy Ghost. Prior to that, He did no miracles. Now, here's the thing. This is a give me, okay? You're not going to go to a church if they don't believe in the baptism, because the power comes from the Holy Ghost, okay? The Holy Ghost has to step in and recreate your human spirit. It was dead. And then He comes in there and He creates it in the life and nature of God. Now you have the Spirit of God. That doesn't mean you have the Holy Ghost as in baptism of the Holy Ghost. It means you have the Spirit of God as in the Spirit that came from God. Then, instantaneously, you're a candidate right then. It can be done all at the same time. He just fills that Spirit that He created. So you're just full of the Holy Ghost. Jesus lived 30 years without the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He did no miracles. Once He got filled, then He starts His earthly ministry, doing miracles. He could not do miracles prior to that. I don't know. I don't have scripture on this. You don't ever find Joseph, his earthly father. Obviously, there's no blood there, but his adopted father. You don't see him around in Jesus' later life. He had to give his mother over to John. Joseph was not at the cross. I don't believe it was that Joseph backslid and went someplace. I personally think Joseph maybe had died at that time. I believe that Jesus had to watch as He's growing up, 28, 29, 30, okay, I'm 27, I'm 28, all kinds of stuff around Him. I can't go do that. You know, Joseph just died, or maybe he did or didn't, I don't know. This one died, that one died. He doesn't step into humanity doing anything until He's filled with the Holy Ghost. Then His earthly ministry starts. That's really cool, but here's the deal. You're not any church, any ministry or church that does not preach the power, it does not teach the power, and does not teach people how to be filled with the power and how to go in, you're not going to see any miracles there. The miracles won't be working. I mean, they may squeeze in something just under the wire every once in a while. It's not because they're unworthy in that sense of the word. There's just no... The power is what brings miracles. And the Holy Ghost is the one who brings the power. He is power. He's raw power. So you're not going to see those things taking place. Here's where it's vitally important for laying hands on the sick. That our concept, and we're going to go to a place in just a moment, that our concept of what we see us doing when we're praying for people, and I'm not just talking about this altar, I'm talking about tomorrow, next week, at your job, your office, your family, whatever, is that the posture, the posture of your, or your disposition by which you're when you go to minister, that you're keeping something, that the doctrine inside of you, that the wisdom inside of you is dictating, helping dictate your faith, helping bring about your faith. We understand that Jesus, we understand that Jesus was God in the flesh, and this is, I'm going to go to a place in just a moment by saying this statement first. We understand that Jesus was God in the flesh, deity in the flesh, but He did, as I just said, no miracles out of his personal deity. I'll read this again, okay? Because it deserves it. We understand, or I hope you understand, I'll say it that way, that Jesus was God in the flesh, deity in the flesh. But He did no miracles out of His, this is the only way I can say it, His personal deity. He did miracles through the anointing by the Holy Spirit, which came from his Father that was resident in his human spirit. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus. Is this important? It's vital. Listen, this don't miss this. It's vital that you understand how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the power of the Holy Ghost, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. The anointing came. How did Jesus do his works? How did he perform miracles? See, this is vital, because if you see, this is vital. If you see Jesus, now we just read, you know, the works that I do, John 14, the works that I do, you'll do also. And we say, amen. I can believe that. I'm going to follow in you, Lord. You're going to. But if our concept, this hones things in a little bit more, and it helps our faith a little bit more. Jesus came into this earth. He's an incredible, I would say being, but with respect, credible person. How he's made up, you just accept it by the word of God. He came as the Logos, a member of the Godhead, into a created body that the Holy Spirit created with Mary. And Jesus, the Logos, came in there, but the humanity, his human spirit that came from God, was also in there. In this sense of the word, too, when the Holy Ghost baptized him, he baptized him or equipped him through his humanity. In other words, when Jesus was walking, he was doing none of his works through his deity, through his own personal deity, because the Holy Ghost was in there, and he's deity, but it was not his own. If you want to say it this way, the best I can explain it, if I get it better later, I'll tell you, his own personal deity was not what he was working with. Is that helps? That helps me. So here's the deal. When we speak of Jesus healing people, it's easy to think of him in a certain special way, like Jesus healed them directly through his own deity, and that's not how he did it. Understanding this is important for us in laying hands on the sick. Let's look at Luke chapter 8. Go there with me, please. Look at verse 41. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come into his house. For he had one only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a dying. But as he went, the people thronged him, and a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood stanched. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, "Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?" And Jesus said, "Somebody hath touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me." And when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. And Jesus said unto her, "Daughter, be of good cheer," or "be of good comfort. Thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace." Hallelujah. Understanding this is important, because the woman with the issue of blood, Luke, what we just read, when the woman with the issue of blood touched his garment, she was healed. The virtue or power came from a place resident inside his human spirit. The Holy Spirit flowed out of Jesus and healed her body. That did not come from a place of Jesus' own personal deity. That came from the Holy Ghost that was within his humanity. Everybody got that? Okay. This is what we all have who are born again and filled with the Holy Ghost. He did not even know who touched him, but God, the Holy Spirit, did. the reason why this is important in laying hands is that our disposition of what happens when we do this. Do you understand? I hope I'm presenting this to where that you understand. Do you understand that it is absolutely based on how Jesus did miracles? And I'm not talking about how he did them. Like he did listen to the Holy Spirit. Sometimes he'd spit. Sometimes he would do this. He would do that. And he didn't do it for theatrics. He did it to follow the Father through the Spirit. But how, when I say how, that power was distributed to him is exactly how the power can and will be, if we allow it to, be distributed through us. The onus is this. The thing is this. Jesus was so stripped of the flesh, in other words, no flesh was a barrier to him, so that when the woman touched him, the power or the virtue, the word virtue is power, the essence of power just flowed through him, even not knowing with his natural mind. It just flowed. So what does that tell us? This sounds blasphemous. You can walk in a place with God. People can walk in a place where truly the works that he did, you'll do also, is that someone could touch you unknowing, the hem of your clothes, and they could receive healing. Wait a minute, Pastor. That's blasphemy. That's Jesus. Yes, it is. And how did he heal people? Did he heal them through his deity? No. He healed them through the anointing that he had received by the Holy Ghost. That's the same way you do. The virtue that flowed out of him, she comes up, touches him. The virtue that flows out of him, he's like, I just felt power come out of me. Now that power didn't come out of my deity. That power came out of my humanity. That's the same power that you and I have living within us. That's why John G. Lake, he just believed that Romans 8, the law of the Spirit of life, which is in Christ Jesus, when I lay my hands on you, he was fascinated with scientific things. And that's where you've heard me tell the story, the bubonic plague. He would have the people come. He actually did this. I don't know, maybe more. I don't know if it was more than once, but he actually had them put the froth of a person's, or the spittle of a dead person, a corpse that had just recently died. You know, they're filled with millions of germs, and they would put that under a microscope first, I guess, and watch its life, and then they would put it in his hands, and repetitively it would die almost immediately touching them. They wondered why, and he said, look, it is a spiritual law. What is coming out of me is it is the law of the Spirit of life. So he understood that laying on of hands, now we don't have time to get into it tonight, that's not the only way of healing. Some, like the centurion, you can send the word. Some, there's anointing for a corporate multitude. How in the world, you know, if you had 10,000 people, you're not going to be able to lay hands on all those people. That has to be a hand grenade explosion kind of anointing where it just goes everywhere. But when you're laying hands on the sick, you ought to realize that that anointing is not coming from outer space. It's not. If you think that when you lay hands on the sick, okay, Father, in the name of Jesus, if you think, okay, I'm waiting for him, if in your mind or if in your disposition that anointing is coming from some place. Now, the Holy Spirit was with Jesus, but he was in Jesus. But Jesus said, the kingdom of God is at hand. And he said to the Pharisees, you'll not see the kingdom of God with observation, saying, lo, here or there is the kingdom of God, because he said the kingdom of God is within you. The anointing doesn't come from out there. It doesn't come from outer space. It doesn't come like, okay, I'm going to pray, and then God, I'm asking you to come. He doesn't come. It's not like he comes from some place. The anointing that heals, it's not your power. It's the Holy Ghost. But that anointing, if the virtue that was in Jesus did not come from his deity, but came from the accentuation of the anointing of the Holy Ghost, and that's all what we all dwell in, then that anointing has to come. He's with us, yes, he's working with us, but he's also in us. That has to come. That's why John G. Lake said, there's something that'll pass from my physical hands into your body. And you should take note of it, that when you're praying for someone, if you're thinking that God's out there and maybe he's coming from outer space, he's right here. He's here. The God here is coming out there. Glory to God. And you should expect immediate results. Now, somebody said, that's really strange, but listen, we won't go there. Oh, no, yes, we will. We got just in Acts, because it's so good. We need to hear this. Acts chapter 5. Somebody said, I don't know about some. Can you imagine? You should imagine. You should imagine yourself walking down the mall or walking someplace, and all of a sudden you're like, whoa. You know, I was just brushed by some people. Now, this woman, God bless her, she had an issue of blood. You know, to be real mannerly, it was probably a womanly thing. She was bleeding for 12 years. Now, you ladies would say, my God, 12 years. She probably had cancer or something in there. And at the moment she touched him. Now, she did not know that this is, she wasn't like, this is the third person, this is the second person of the Godhead. This is the mighty Logos. She just knew that God was with this man. She just knew that wherever this man goes, God shows up. And if I can touch him, I'm believing I'll get some of God out of him. And so she goes and touches him, and that virtue flows to her, and immediately she knew the blood stopped. The blood stopped. She's like, oh man, the blood has just stopped. Do you think she was a happy camper? Oh my God. Oh my God. And Jesus, I love this. I don't know how he did this. I don't know how, but see, that's where he's God, you know, and I don't have to figure that out. How in the world somebody could actually separate, could be one, but separate themselves in a category to say, okay, I'm God over here, but I won't go there. I won't see. But the Holy Ghost knew that she was going to touch him, and his brain in the human was like, I don't know who touched me. He wasn't joking. He didn't know. He really didn't know. But the virtue came out of his spirit, his human, born again. That's where the Holy Spirit resonates, and that's where that anointing is at. Can you imagine walking through a place and somebody saying, I know those people, they pray. I seen them. They were praying for other people. You know, I can't, you know, if they couldn't get to you somehow, if they could just touch you. And then all of a sudden you feel, I don't know, somebody touched me here that was believing God for a miracle. You say, man, that makes you too much like Jesus. No, listen, if you see that the miracles came from, if you think that the miracles came out of, well, that's Jesus. Listen, yes, now he's ascended to the right hand of the Father, and all virtue is the Holy Spirit administers all virtue through his finished work, okay? But he did his works just like you and I will do our works, but our work is in him, in faith in him of his finished work. But if you think that he did his work through his deity, that's not how he did it. So somebody could touch you. Well, look at this. Look at this anointing. You talk about the hem of the garment anointing. What about, let's go here. Let's get this one. Acts chapter 5, verse 15. Inasmuch that they, now this, the revival is raging. Inasmuch as that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Jesus passing by, what? A mere mortal? Peter's shadow passing by might overshadow some. And there came also a great or a multitude out of the cities around about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folk. And with them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed every one. Hallelujah. Well, I don't know about that what you just said about if somebody could possibly touch me and the anointing could come out of me and heal them like it. Well, if you have a hard time with that one, you sure got a hard time with a shadow anointing. I mean, you know, just all kind of sick folks, devil-possessed people. And this isn't Jesus. This is Peter. And by the way, this helps us. This goes right back to that message that the Holy Spirit's been saying to us. Don't wait till your imperfections are perfect to get inside the harvest. Peter had a hard time with Gentiles. Racism. Sorry, Peter. And he got healed of it. But Jesus is, God is healing him. Okay? God is changing him. So his shadow, just walking, and he healed. God healed every single one of them. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 19. Here's another example of the power that works. This is one that we use all the time. And it is, let's see, I had it in my notes. Acts 19, verse 11 and 12, it says, "And God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them." Okay, this is the same. Is that not just, isn't that what Jesus, I mean, they touched the hem of his garment. It doesn't matter if Paul was, it was on Paul's body, and it was sent to him. Same difference. And it was like Paul, now we pray over these things, and there's nothing wrong with that. We lay hands on it. But it actually just said that, it just sounds like that he had them on him. He just wore them. You know, I've watched David Hogan a lot of times. He'll have, he looks funny, but it's pretty cool. He'll preach with like all these handkerchiefs hanging off of him, you know. And he just gets under the anointing and all these handkerchiefs. And I guess after the service, he gives them out, you know, to where. But so we're not trying to figure out a new way to do it. We're just saying, actually, it just says that it was taken from his body. You know, he had these and it was sent out into, you know, we remember we studied Asia Minor, that's Turkey, and devils went out of people. People were, that were, why? Because they touched the hem of Jesus' garment, really. And the virtue, Paul was working, and what excites me about all that is that's us. Those are real people. That's not angels we're talking about. We're talking about real people. That is going to work in and through us, and it is. If we say now, now's the time. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Are you getting anything out of this? So just some real practical things. Here's another thing too. Matthew 9, and we're getting real close to being done. Matthew 9, always remember too, because we're kind of training you to lay hands on the sick. Always remember, number one, listen to the Holy Spirit. What does he say about this? And the way you pray, I try not to. I'm having a ride. I don't do shotgun prayers. Like, I try to be specific as possible, but not overly specific. If the anointing is there, just get her done, okay? But I also try to detect, look, here's the thing. I am not of the disposition that all sickness is hereditary, going back all the way from the garden, coming from the fall, which Satan originated. Okay. But not all flus and viruses and everything was directly. Now, you know, the devil can come something with something and really try to put it on somebody's body. But a lot of times Christians are just catching stuff because it's out there. My granddaughters today didn't have no devil, you know. And I don't believe the devil actually just directly you know, I didn't discern that he had directly brought that, but they probably picked it up at school, or they picked it. So there's certain sicknesses and diseases or certain kinds of things, like when you pray, you discern, okay, get it out of there. Jesus will heal it, whether there's a direct devil fuel in it, or if it's just like a virus that's just hitting everybody. But listen, folks, just because we have spiritual minds don't mean we blot out the science. Science is subject to us, and we take his word above all science, but we know there's germs. We know if you, you know, if you touch stuff and you do this and that and the other, that's why you live in a faith that no deadly thing will harm me. And if I, you know, if I pick up a, you know, if I'm around people that are sick, I'm not going to be worried. I'm, you know, it's going to just, it's not, that's not going to harm me. But certain things are past, not because there's a direct devil, but because it's just, it's in the air. Okay. So we have to understand that. And when you're praying for people a lot, but listen, those things that are, you know, cancer also can be a breakdown in somebody's body from years and years of just abusing it. But in so many cases, there's a direct devil there that has brought that thing about. And by the way, and I'm not saying this about her, because I just made that statement, because I'm not equivocating the two. Please be praying for Sister Callie Pearl. And those of you that are listening, we have a patron saint, per se, that has been with us for many, many years, Sister Callie Pearl. She's over in Daytona. I talked to her a few days, or last week, and she said one doctor says she's got about 3 to 4 months. She doesn't get out of bed now. And without a miracle, she'll go home to see Jesus. So these are ones we fight for. We just fight against all odds. The odds are looking in our, you know, they don't look in our favor. They don't look like, but we just keep marching and we keep saying, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So let me read this. This is where I was at, reading this from Matthew chapter 9. And this is an important thing. Not only listen to the Holy Spirit, but also this practical part, or not, this is practical, but it's also very, very spiritual. In 28, verse 28, and when he was come, that's speaking of Christ, when he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus saith unto them, believe ye that I am able to do this? And they said unto him, yes, Lord. Then he touched their eyes, saying, according to your faith be it unto you. And their eyes were open, and Jesus straightly charged them, saying, see that no man know it. Okay, so I'm going to use that scripture as an example to say this. A lot of times when you're praying for people and you're about to lay hands on people, if they know that you have a really strong relationship with the Lord, and they know that even at testimonies make a big difference, that you can testify that God has been doing these things through my life, then Jesus would often do a couple of different things. Jesus would often do this. Jesus would say, what do you want? Because he would be like, he would just make no assumptions. A lot of times he would just, you know, he would do the direct work. But a lot of times if people would come to him and he'd say, well, you know, I mean, a blind person coming, you'd think, okay, I know what their needs are. But Jesus would say, what do you want? Because he's soliciting from them a level of their want and their faith. But Jesus asked them, he says, do you believe that I can do this? Or do you believe, let's say it this way, do you believe if I pray that God will do this through my prayers? A lot of times God will use your reputation, if you want to say it that way, or a believability. Sometimes, let's see, how did Gary say that? He said now I might not get this straight, but he said a lot of times the Lord would use him to build somebody's faith by saying, look, do you believe if I pray for you, that God will heal you? Do you believe in my prayer for you? And in other words, God will use someone. God can initiate somebody's faith in your faith for them. You got that? In other words, God can initiate a faith. Somebody can have faith that you have faith. So now that makes it clear. And so he said he's seen people heal that way. So a lot, if you have that, you can ask people, look, like, do you believe if I do it, you think it'll work? Yes. We had an opportunity to pray for a sweet young lady here Sunday. And she's kind of small for her age. I think she's about 12, I later found out. Her name's Haley. She was diagnosed with juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. And so that's a supposedly a crippler. It's bad. And I could tell that, you know, the family really didn't know so much about Christ. I did ask the little girl, and she was so sweet. Candy said it was sweet. I said, do you know Jesus? Have you ever received him as your Lord and Savior? She turned around to her mom, and what'd she say? I have no idea. I have no idea what I don't know what he's saying. So I explained. I said, Jesus came, and he do you know he died on the cross? Yes. And I said, well, he did that for you, and he did that so you could go to heaven if you believe that he died for you. And I said, if I pray, will you pray with me? And she said she would. And so we prayed, and we prayed that she would be born again. And then we prayed concerning that particular disease. But I think I asked her, I said, do you believe if I pray for you that God will heal you? And she said yes. So you can initiate people's faith by saying, sometimes it's good to give them a few testimonies and say, man, God, you're not building your reputation, but you're building your reputation in their eyes for him to come and say, look, I'm going to do, God will do something. So based on what I just told you, and you know what, how God has used me before in the past, and what we teach and believe at our church, do you believe that my prayers will get through for you? Do you believe if I pray, God will heal you? Yes. Okay, let me pray for you. So that works. Hallelujah. Amen. That's good for tonight. Praise the Lord. Did you receive something? Amen. I'm just waiting for one of you to come back and say, they touched the hem of my jeans. All right, let's all stand together. Hallelujah. Father, we just praise you and we thank you for your great grace in our life, preparing us for this harvest. We ask you to take us in to the fullness in the days ahead. And we thank you, Father, during this holiday season, that, Lord, that you meet and supply all of their needs according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Bless now these that have been listening to here tonight physically and those that are listening to the Lord, the YouTube and the website. We thank you for, Father, all these good things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Hallelujah.